I really believe there is a secret for a meaningful and joyful life. And the secret is not having all the answers, but being able to ask the right questions. If you know how to ask the right questions, you will always have a meaningful and joyful and fulfilled life. And today I want to share with you 7 questions that changed my life. 7 questions that made me who I am and made me wake up every day knowing that today could be the last day of my life. So I need to enjoy it, and I need to do everything I need to do today. I can't wait for tomorrow. And this is what these questions made to me. And I hope it does the same thing to you. I'm gonna share a few of them here on YouTube, some of them later on our Patreon. But nevertheless, I hope you enjoy it. And I really hope this inspires you to become a better person and to have a fulfilled and meaningful life. Let's go. All right, no fluffing around. I want to go straight to the point. Question number one. I'm going to read because I don't want to get this wrong. Question number one. If you live exactly the same way you're living for the last 2 weeks, what will be the result in the next 30 years? Where will you end up? You know, maybe you're 20, maybe you're 30. And if you continue to live the same way you have been living for the last 2 weeks, just the 2 weeks, when you're 60 or 70, where do you see yourself? And here's a backlash question. What's the regret? What are you missing? Think about that for a while. Like I said, it's not about having the right answers. It's about asking the right questions. Recently, I shared with a group of, like, these 2 receptionists at my daughter's school. It's funny. Every time I drop them, if I have something deep, I tell them, hey, you want to hear something deep? And then I approach the desk and they write down what I say. Literally, they're my first followers. They write down what I say. And I told them, you will always find what you're looking for. You will always find what you're looking for. So at the end of the day, if you're frustrated with your day, you should not ask yourself when you're reflecting, when you sit by the, you know, by the foot of the bed, you shouldn't reflect, what have I got out of today? You should reflect upon the question, what was I looking for? Because you will always find what you're looking for. If you go around looking for negative things, you will find negative things. If you go around looking for positive things, you will find positive things. You just have to look for it. One of the most common regrets that people have when they die is a regret of not living a life that they designed for themselves. A life with purpose, which is, again, it's my specialty. I've been living my dream for the last 15 years. I'll tell you more about it, but you don't want to do that. You don't want to do that. You know, Steve Jobs became famous for this. It's very controversial, but he used to say, if you wake up 3 days in a row, look in the mirror and don't like what you see, you gotta change. Because the reality of life is nothing changes if you don't change. It all starts with you. Nothing changes if you don't change. And here is a very stoic thinking. I love this idea. Are you ready for this? This is gonna hurt. I'm telling you, it's gonna hurt, but it's gonna be good for you. Everything is your fault. It's your fault. It's not my fault. Hey, you lost your job. It's your fault. It's not the it's not the boss's fault. It's not the environment. It's not the economy. Because there's a lot of people who are holding jobs right now. It's your fault. Everything that is in your control, things that you can do, is your fault. And everything that's out of your control, the weather, the rain, it's your fault too. It's your fault too. And this is how the Stoics think. You know why? Because at the end of the day, you might not be in control of the rain, but you are in control of how you react to the rain. You're in control. You might not be in control of an accident. You know, maybe you're rolling your trolley out of the supermarket and then you stumble over something and the groceries fall on the floor. I don't know. I don't even know where I got this example from. But anyway, and you go like, damn, I'm gonna have to pick this all up. Or then you can think, maybe there's something around here that I should be enjoying. Providence, destiny, God might have allowed you to do that because you're in control of how you react. It's your fault. Your life, your fault. Think about that. I'll give you a personal example. The job that I do, I lead an organization that is focused on finding, training, and releasing people to go and fulfill their destiny, plant churches, preach the gospel. It's a beautiful thing. I live my dream, can't complain. Recently, we brought a new guy in. We have a love-hate relationship. He's very smart, so he's like, man, like it's hard to describe. Anyway, He knows all this, so this is not a secret. We've been bumping horns. Until recently, when I realized, you know what? If we're bumping horns, it's my fault. Because I am being incompetent in dealing with the situation. So I have to take a step back, because like John Maxwell says, everything rises and falls in leadership. And if you consider yourself a leader, it's your fault. Everything rises and falls on leadership. So I took a step back and I said, hey, maybe we started with the wrong foot. Let's start again. And then hopefully this will work. I don't know the results yet. I'm leaving the situation, but I'm expectant. I'm hopeful. I think it's going to work. So that's question number one. If you've been living the same, if you live the same way you've been living for the last 2 weeks, what will be the end result? And what will be the regrets? Question number two. Like I said, I want to read because I want to get this wrong. I don't want to get this wrong. Is there any unexpressed part within you or unexplored behavior or endeavor outside of you that you are suppressing because of the opinions of others? I know it's complicated, but let me put it another way. Is there anything you want to do that you are not doing because of other people's opinion? And if there is, what will be your regret? When you get old, again, at the end of your life, will you regret not doing that? Or will you be, is it worth it not doing it? What is it that you're suppressing that you are not doing it? And this is social conformity. We are taught that way. We go to school and they teach us to conform to a standard, to a pattern, and not think outside the box. We are not trained to think outside the box. We are trained to fulfill a mission. History says that a long time ago, hundreds of years ago, John Rockefeller needed workers for his industries and factories. So he proposed to the government to subsidize what we call today public schools, to train workers for his factories. And hundreds of years later, we're still doing the same thing. So a question again, is there anything you're not doing because of the opinions of others? Because I'll tell you what, in 30 years' time, your circle will be different. Our circle changes. And I have a video about this, you know, the people in our lives, so the time you spend with your friends, the time you spend with the people in college, workmates, your family, your circle is gonna change. And when that changes, here's the bad news. Those people that are stopping you from doing what you feel like you're called to do, they will not be there. I know it's harsh, but they won't. There are very few people that stick around for your whole life. And we have to be okay with that. I remember, again, another personal example. When I was 17, 18, I had a very rocky relationship with my dad. I had tried to kill my dad 3 times. And in his last attempt to, quote unquote, fix me, he proposed to me that he wanted to pay for my college degree. But he had a condition. He said, I will pay for your college degree if you want to do engineering. And I said no. Thinking back, I should have said yes. I probably would have a better financial situation, I guess. But when he said it, the reason why I said no, I had dreams and aspirations. I wanted to be an NBA player and all of that. All, you know, youthful thinking. But bottom line, I knew that wasn't me. Now, fast forward, gosh, this is like 25 years ago. Fast forward 25 years, I'm 40 years old. I have 2 beautiful daughters. I've been married for the same woman for 20 years. I love my life. And I tell you, this is not empty propaganda. I live the dream every day. I wake up to fulfill my mission. There is not an ounce of regret in my life every single day. You can be envious, you can be jealous. It's your problem, not mine. I'm only responsible for what I say. I'm not responsible for how you get it. This is the idea. Like, I live my dream. If I was an engineer today, I'm not sure if I would be that happy. Honestly, and it's not about money. It's not about wealth. I could do with a little bit more money, I'll tell you that. But I am super happy. I am joyful. My life is meaningful. If I die today, I can guarantee you, there might not be many people in my funeral, but everyone there will say, man, this guy made a difference in my life. So that's what I want. That's what we call legacy. So again, I'll ask you the question. If you're not doing anything because of other people, is it worth it? Why? Why don't you just think outside the box? Try the different approach. Try the alternative. I have the impression that you'll be happier if you try. Well, question number three, let's move on. Question number three. If you die tomorrow, is there anything you would regret not saying? Every time I ask myself this question, I told you, these seven questions, they changed my life. So every time I ask myself these questions, especially this one, I heard Gary Vee a long time ago saying, when I wake up, the reason why I have so much gratitude is because no one's dead. There's no family, no relative, no close person that's been dead tragically today. So I'm happy, I'm grateful. And maybe over the last 2 or 3 years, I wake up every day and I put my feet on the ground and I spend like 2 or 3 minutes just saying a quick prayer. And one of the things that I thank God for, and I don't even know why I thank God for, because I'm pretty sure heaven's better than this, but I just say, I'm grateful to be alive. I'm grateful that I get to, you know, be the difference and make the difference in someone's life. And I just take a deep breath. And every now and again, I'm driving. I don't know if it happens to you. Maybe it's my midlife crisis thing, but I'm driving and I'm like, man, my lungs are working. This is good. My heart's beating. This is good. Man, thank God. You know, when you're 20, you don't think about these things. So here's the question. If you die tomorrow, what is it that you will regret not saying? And then I have a subsequent question. Why? Why are you not saying it? You know, I remember when Whitney Houston died, and I've said this before, when Whitney Houston died, Pastor Marvin Wayans and his family, they were celebrating the funeral, and one of the brothers sang that song Tomorrow by Whitney Houston. And then he said, tomorrow might be too late. So if there is anyone that's you've been waiting to call, let's make an experiment. You can pause this video right here, and you go and give them a call. Send them a text. You know, interrupt this right now. That's fine. When you do it, I will see all my insights on the YouTube channel. That's fine. I'm happy for my video to be interrupted right in the middle if you take action. At the end of the day, my goal is to inspire people to move. So let's go. You stop right now. Drop the video and go tell them. Pick up the phone and say, hey, you're a dick. I hate you. No. Don't do that. Don't do that. You just give them a call and say something meaningful. Say, look, I love you, man. I love you. Like, I've been missing you. I remember what you did. And this has shaped my life, changed my life, because people need to hear it. And trust me, you might be the only person who will remember to do that for them. That might be life changing. You will be surprised how many people are on the verge of doing something tragic with their life for lack of recognition. So you can be the strong person in the relationship right now. Stop. And if you haven't yet, you can hit pause. Do it, and then we're gonna move on to the next question. But let's make a pact. You know, let's make a pact. We are gonna be the say everything people right now, or say everything right now kind of people. That's it. We're gonna be the say everything right now kind of people. We're not gonna leave any stone unturned. We're gonna turn every stone. We're gonna say everything, even if it hurts. But we will. You know, maybe this is the time that you had a break in the relationship. She walked away. She booked the ticket. She grabbed the bags. She ran away. And then you realize the mistake you made. And then you run out of the apartment. You call the taxi, and it's raining, and it's cold. And the violin is playing, and the sad song is playing in the movie. And the taxi driver is going super fast, and it's going through all the red lights. And you get to the airport, and she's right there at the gate. She's about to board the plane. And then right before she boards the plane and gives the tickets, you yell, no, don't go. Don't go. I love you. Then you get on your knees. You propose in the middle of the airport. Everybody claps. You're happily ever after. That's beautiful. Maybe that's your moment. Or maybe you won't do it. And she'll go. You regret. What's going to be? It's up to you. Because at the end of the day, it's your fault. It's not mine. It's not hers. It's yours. All right, we're going to move on, but before we move on, let me tell you something. First of all, you know, there's a lot of people that watch these videos. They're not even subscribed to this channel. And granted, this whole social media is rubbish. I don't even know how this works, but if you can, hit subscribe here. I think it will help us keep in touch. And second, I'd love to tell you about this thing that's coming up. You know, when you hit subscribe, There's a bunch of links down below. There's my website right here. I would love to encourage you to go on my website. On my website, we have built this whole thing about helping people find their purpose. This is a book that I wrote. I wrote this book, believe it or not. I know, you think I'm not that smart. I ain't. But this is my book. I'm super proud of it. And it's going to be published at the end of the year. But I'm inviting people to have a first look. It's like a glance, you know? And there's going to be a few things there that only this community is going to see. So when you go on my website and you subscribe to that list, you'll be involved, you get the emails, and you get it first, and you get it cheaper. Don't tell anybody, okay? Just you. You get it cheaper. So you go in there, go on the website, subscribe, you hear more about it. It's coming up at the end of the year, but I'm just working towards it, and I will be super honored if you do me the favor to click the link, subscribe, and let's roll. Question number four is a very practical question. It's about priorities, prioritizing. Here's the question. What is truly important to you regarding the limited time you have on this planet? I don't know if you realize it, but all my questions have to do with finitude. Like the things are coming to an end. So you have to enjoy. So what is it that is really important to you regarding your limited time? I'll give you an example. I can be replaced in a lot of things, but I can't be replaced as a dad. Only I can be a dad to my daughters. I hope only I can be a husband to my wife because that's a unique role. There are not many unique roles that I feel. You know, someone can replace me as a pastor. Someone can replace me as a YouTuber, or whatever that is. Someone can replace me as a lot of things. But a dad and a husband, there are two things that I can't be replaced. Those are really important. Even, I don't know if you remember when I said this, but I like to categorize things. The essential, the crucial, and the important things. Essential, crucial, and important. Very briefly, the essential things are things that just flow out of you naturally. So Jesus taught us to love one another. That's the main commandment. That should be essential. That should flow out of us regardless of where we are and any structure or anything. And then there's the crucial things. Like in your life, if you do them, your life will work. And if you don't, it won't work. Example, unfortunately, because nobody likes to work, unfortunately, you have to work. Because you gotta pay bills. We live in a capitalist world. So that's crucial. If you don't work, your life won't work, literally. But if you do work, you get paid, you get to pay the bills. And if you're diligent, you can save some money, you can invest, you can build a comfortable life. And then there are the important things. The important things, it's the final toppings, you know, the details. They make it beautiful. So you go to a church, for example, music is not really crucial. You don't need music. But it's important, like, it makes it beautiful. Like we just sing together, you know, that's just one example of many others. So making the question even better, I won't even use the word important. What is it that is crucial in our life? You can't live life regarding your limited time on earth without it. If you've never heard of the Eisenhower quadrant, I would like to introduce you to that. The Eisenhower is a philosophy organizing your life around four things. What is important and not urgent, important and urgent, not important and not urgent, and not important and urgent. It's complicated. So just think important and urgent. Important and urgent, important, not urgent. Not important and urgent, not important and not urgent. So what's not important and not urgent, you just dish it. You don't want to do it. What's not important, but it's urgent, might be an accident or might be, you know, it might not even involve anything that's close to you, but it's urgent. You got to act. So it comes on top of the list every now and again and it disturbs your day. What is important and not urgent, it's what you plan for. This is like, this is where you want to live, where things are very important. You want to spend your time here and not urgent because urgency is kind of it's difficult to live in urgency. And then there are the very important and very urgent things which you have to put on top of the list. But anyway, I don't want to be too deep into the Eisenhower quadrant, but go and research that. I have more videos about that right here on the description, same videos. You can look them up. It's going to do you well. But think about that question. What is really crucial regarding your limited time on earth? And how are you making or building your life around that? That's question number four. Question number five, and I'm about to finish. I'm going to finish with this one. I said I was going to do seven, but you're going to have to jump on our Patreon if you want to do the six and seven. But question number five, here it is. How many times did you see your parents over the last 30 days? Oh, I know it hurts. How long do they probably have left to live? How many times you will be with them before it's over? And how can you make this moment count? But like, I'm gonna read this again. This is tough. And before I read this again, it's funny that I'm referencing my own videos. This is not self-promotion. I just believe my content. I really do. I made a video about the seasons of life and the people that you spend time with. Your friends from childhood, your friends from school, your co-workers, your family members. So it's all in there. It's a beautiful video. It's about 20 minutes. Really reflective. I would love for you to watch. The link is down there. I'm gonna try to put a card right here, but you can search on my, it's called Who Are They on my channel. Go ahead and watch it. I think you're gonna love it. But I'm gonna ask the question again and I'll just let you think. I'm not gonna develop too much into that. How many times did you see your parents over the last 30 days? The reason why that hit so hard for me is because I live on the other side of the world from my parents. I'm in Australia. They're in Brazil. I get to see them once every couple of weeks when I'm on the phone. My kids are growing up without grandparents. Don't get me wrong, it's my fault. I made that choice because I weighed out the options and I thought it was a better option. But every choice comes with a consequence. I'm providing a better lifestyle for my kids, yes. There's more opportunity, yes. But there is a lack right here. And I can't fulfill that lack. Nothing will fulfill that lack. Yes, they will be complete in Jesus Christ. I'm trying to teach them the ways of faith, yes. But they will still miss their grandparents. That's inevitable. Okay, that's inevitable. Deal with it, people. I tell my kids, you know, grow up, suck it up. Because we have to deal with pain. Christianity equals pain. We have to learn how to deal with suffering. But anyway, that's a different topic. How many times did you see your parents over the last 30 days? If you live close to your parents, look, damn you. If you live close to your parents, you're accountable. I'm really mad at you if you don't go see them. You know, if your parents live in the same city, man, I feel like cussing. I can't cuss because this is bad. But if you live in the same city as your parents, you should go and see them right now. Because you will regret not doing it when you get old. And again, second question. How long do they have before it's over? You don't know what tomorrow holds, man. I am shocked by the amount of kids that grow up without parents. Their parents die when they're 40, 35, 45. I'm on a season in my life where I see more funerals than birthday parties. That's scary. And when you realize that the countdown is going down, the clock is running over, and then most of the people that used to be around you are not there anymore, and you're next in line, things change. Perspective change. So how long do they have left? How many times will you be with them? Like, can you count the Christmas? Is Christmas enough? Is Easter enough? Are the holidays enough? Nah, man, just make time because that's crucial. That's your Eisenhower right there. That's crucial. I know this is really deep. Some people might get sad when they watch these videos. Shame on you. You shouldn't get sad. You should be convicted. And you should turn around and do something about it. You know, send them a message. Go spend time with them. Go make your life count. Stop wasting your air. Stop wasting my air. It's mine too. We live in the same planet. You're sucking up air and you're doing nothing with your life. Get up, grow up air, go be significant in life. You need to make your life significant. It cannot be a waste, man. God gave you life. I told you that many times. How many times do I have to repeat it? Your life is a gift from God to you, but the way you live your life is your gift to God. Imagine if God looks at your life and goes like, that's a bum of a gift. That's a lame gift. I don't want that. I want God to look at my life and go like, man, this is my favorite gift. My favorite toy. I love to play with it. Like, that's how I want. So that's what I want and that's what I wish for you. So these are my 5 questions on YouTube. I do have 2 more. But if you want more, you're gonna have to come on our Patreon. Patreon is our private community. It's different from our website or anything. It's just something I created for the people who really want it. You know, I think this is very superficial. This is very trivial, very menial. And you know, who knows where my videos are gonna end up on YouTube. But on our Patreon community, you get to be part of what I do. Not just watch. This is my attempt to say, I don't wanna build an audience. I wanna form a community. I would love for you to be part of our community, part of our family. You get to give your opinion about what do you want to see and what do you want to discuss and participate in the events that we do. Anyway, there's a lot in there. So if you want more, like the deep questions that I'm about to go into, you go on our Patreon. It's just patreon.com/PedroOnPurpose. That simple. Patreon.com/PedroOnPurpose. The link is in the description too. You go in there. But if you don't want to go there, if you don't want to commit to anything, that's fine. I think you should watch this video, and this video will take you to something really, really deep. Hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you on the next one. So it's a good day.